Hi, everybody. It's good to be here with you again. We are here at Cheviot United Methodist Church in our sanctuary, and we're going to be blessed with some wonderful music today, so I'm glad that you're joining us. I know that many people are saying that they're getting really, really anxious to come back and to worship in person, and I am too. We're going to be talking about that tonight and starting that process of deciding when we're going to reopen, and we'll let you know as soon as that's the case. If you're joining us from somewhere other than the Cheviot area and you have begun to listen to these worship services online, we're really glad that you're here. I just want to tell you about a couple things I'm excited about. This church is such an amazing community church. We are here for our community of Cheviot and surrounding communities, and we want to be here for you, especially during this time. But here's a couple things that you might be interested in getting involved in. On Memorial Day, on Monday at 9 a.m., we are going to be doing a walk around the neighborhood, kind of a prayer walk, and we're just going to be praying for our community. And so if you want to come join us in the parking lot at 9 o'clock, you can walk with us, get to know some new folks. And after that, then, we're going to have a food drive where you can drive in and bring us your canned goods, and we'll help to keep our local pantries well stocked. Another thing that's happening in the middle of June is that we're doing a online vacation Bible school. So our children's ministers have put together a really, really fun activity for a couple of days for our kids that they can do from home. And it's called Bolt. So be looking on our website and on our Facebook page for more information to get your kids involved in this. I think they're going to have a really good time. But now we want to just kind of prepare our hearts for worship, and so we're going to listen to some wonderful music from Carol and Marcia. Thank you. That was beautiful. You can hear that every Sunday morning once we're back in worship in person. Right now, I just want to take a moment and right where you are, wherever you're listening, just invite you to rest for a moment, to breathe, to notice the silence around you, and to know that the presence of God is with you. wherever we are, whether we're in a sanctuary or in our bedroom or in living rooms or our car, wherever we are, He is with us. And we want to lift up our prayers to Him right now together. Lord, I thank You for this day, for the way that You have sustained us day by day through a very uncertain time. I thank You for the way You have brought Your church together, encouraged us to do new things. I thank You for the new people that are joining us in many different ways. And we believe that You have a purpose in all of this. And so today, as we talk about the challenges of this pandemic that we are facing, and we learn that You are a God of comebacks in the midst of our setbacks, we ask that these words would touch the hearts of those who need them, that Your Spirit would make this scripture come alive, make the message relevant, and would give us the needed hope that we need to continue to persevere until we are all back together again. We ask all these things in Your precious name. Amen. We are blessed to have wonderful musicians in our church, and we want to thank Heather Rausch for being with us today to share her musical talent with us.
Nothing that can't be done by me and God. Ain't nobody gonna come between me and God. One day we'll live together where the angels trod, me and God. Early in the morning, talking it over, me God. Late at night, talking it over, me and God. You could say we're like two peas in a pod, me and God. He's my Father, He's my friend, the beginning and the end. He rules the world with His staff and rod. We're a team, me and God. I am weak and He is strong, me and God. He forgives me when I'm wrong, me and God. He's the one I lean on when life gets hard, me and God. He's my Father, He's my friend, the beginning and the end. He rules the world with His staff and a rod. We're a team, me and God. We're a team, me and God. We're a
just introduce our topic today. We're talking about where God is in the midst of our setbacks and how he brings us a comeback out of those. But specifically today, we're talking about where he is in the midst of failure. And I want to read our scripture today. It comes from Isaiah chapter 40, beginning in verse 27. So if you have your Bibles handy and you want to follow along with us, let's read the Word of God together. Isaiah says, "Why do you complain, Jacob? Why do you say, Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord? My cause is disregarded by my God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint." The Word of God for the people of God. And if you were all here together, I know you would say, thanks be to God. We are so thankful to God for these words of encouragement and hope. And especially in times that are uncertain, like now, we know that some of you, I'm going to open my computer here, some people, this pandemic has been going on and dragging on, and I know that we're losing our patience, and for people who are struggling financially, it can become a very fearful time, especially if you are fearing maybe the loss of a business or the loss of plans that you had. But let's begin with a little bit of humor. I got sent a couple of jokes this week, and I don't often tell jokes because my husband is the professional comedian in the family, but I like these. This was one that my sister sent me. It said, "Here are some thoughts on the last 12 weeks of quarantine. Breaking news. Wearing a mask inside your home is now highly recommended. Not so much to stop COVID-19, but to stop you from eating." I can relate to that. "Here is a new monthly budget for the pandemic. Gas, $0. Entertainment, $0. Clothes, $0. Groceries, $2,799. That looks a little bit like our budget. Someone else said, "Never in a million years would I imagine that I would go up to a bank teller wearing a mask and ask for money." So, well, I want to just maybe introduce myself to those of you that are coming online and might not know me. I'm Pastor Carrie Jennett. I've been the pastor here at Chevy at UMC for about 2.5 years now. I'm married to a wonderful guy, and he's behind the camera right now. He makes his living, at least until this pandemic started, making people laugh, me included. He's a professional stand-up comedian and has been for 30 years. And he's the funniest guy I know. And he's not even paying attention to me right now when I'm talking, but that's okay. I have one son, Miles, who is 21, and he is a junior in college right now and a great musician in his own right. And we are just blessed to be part of this church. We want everybody to know about this church and to find out about it. I think it's kind of like a diamond in the rough, but hopefully that won't be the case forever. But wherever I go, I talk about Chevy United Methodist and these people who are together learning to live an authentic Christian life, not just on Sunday morning, but from Monday to Saturday. I grew up in Tiffin, Ohio, up in northern Ohio, as the youngest of four girls. My dad was a Marine fighter pilot in World War II and then owned an insurance business. And my mom was a wonderful pianist, a teacher, a seamstress, and a really great mom. And later in life, when my dad became ill, she took over his business and proved to be a successful business owner way before it was popular for women to do that. She passed away from cancer, unfortunately, when I was just 30 years old, about 32 years ago. But my three sisters and I have remained very close, and they're very important to me. I've been a pastor just for the past 13 years. Ministry was a second career for me. I spent a good part of my life in the golf business, first playing professionally and then running golf facilities in Ohio and Florida and California. And when I was 46 years young, I felt a call to ministry, and God changed the direction of my life dramatically. In 2007, I and a group of what I would call local missionaries stepped out on a bold adventure to start a church for the homeless and poor in downtown Middletown. The reason that I tell you all of this is that in that journey from being a kid growing up in Tiffin to becoming a professional golfer and then a pastor, God has been teaching me some things about our topic today that I want to share with you. He's been teaching me about where he is in the midst of failure. As I said, I think this is a timely topic for many people because some of you may be looking at a potential failure of a business or failure of plans or just fear of that happening. But I know that God has something he wants us to know to help us see failure differently and to move beyond our fears. So although my early life was full of wonderful things, our life was not problem-free. My dad struggled most of his life with depression that became more severe as he grew older. Today, people talk about depression much more than they used to, but back then, it was pretty much a mystery. And if you've learned anything about it, you know what a toll that any kind of mental illness can take on a person's life, on a marriage, on family life. And so in my early childhood years, I saw my dad building his own house and running a successful business and raising four crazy girls, not a simple task at all. But later in life, especially in my high school years, his depression became much worse. You learn when you live with someone with this condition that their emotional state can change rapidly from day to day. And as a kid, you learn to become, I guess, hypervigilant, kind of watching for the signs of how the most important person in your life is feeling from day to day. And you also learn that although today might seem like a good day, tomorrow can change quickly. There's always and always was an underlying sense that failure was just around the corner. I could never put my finger on it, but it seemed to be lurking in the shadows. Because at that age, your well-being is tied up very closely with your parents. And as strong and courageous as my dad was and how much he loved his family, his struggle with depression eventually took a toll on my parents' marriage and on our financial stability. I struggled for many years to understand that if God is who he says he is, why did our family situation seem to end in failure? We were not regular churchgoers when I was growing up, but we did attend occasionally. My parents taught us many good things about how to be respectful, how to treat others, how to just be nice people. But we didn't learn much about how to deal with impending failure. But what I would come to learn later in life is that when you come to know Jesus, you no longer need to wait for the failure that feels like it's right around the corner. You no longer need to fear failure that is going to be the end of your story, because he is going to make something out of that failure. When you know Christ, you have a solid rock, an immovable presence, a faithful and sure source of hope. You have someone who will be with you always, who will never change, and who will renew your strength day by day. It was that relationship that began in a little white steeple church in Medina, Ohio, that would be the foundation for understanding where God is in failure and what he intends to do with it. But after serving in ministry over the years, I've learned something else. I have learned that I was not the only person, not the only Christian who believed in God but still had a tendency to fear failure. In 2010, Craig Groeschel wrote a captivating book called The Christian Atheist. The subtitle is Believing in God but Living as If He Doesn't Exist. Pretty interesting title. Some of the chapter titles are this: When You Believe in God but You're Ashamed of Your Past. When You Believe in God but Aren't Sure that He Loves You. When You Believe in God but Still Worry All the Time. All of these are common characteristics of Christians who from time to time can forget the promises of God, who can forget a God who cannot break his promises. But one chapter title that is noticeably absent from the book could be this: When You Believe in God but Are Defeated by Failure. Or When You Believe in God but You Think Your Failure is Permanent. Many Christians who say that they believe in Jesus, who pray to Jesus, and who say they trust in him, can still fall into that trap of thinking that failure in life is a permanent condition. They can live their whole life either stuck in past failures or worrying about future failures. But when we know Christ, we need never fear that failure is permanent. Because what we call failure, Jesus just uses to grow us and change us and to use us for the next thing he has in mind. He loves to show off in the midst of our failure and turn it around for our good. Our scripture today says, Why do you complain, Jacob? Why do you say, Israel, my way is hidden to the Lord, my cause is disregarded by my God? This is a rhetorical question that really needs no answer, because the writer is just saying, of course, there is no need for complaining. Of course, there is no need for worry. Of course, God sees your situation. It is not hidden. God cares about our failure. He does not disregard it. To disregard something means to pay no attention to it, to ignore it. But this verse says that God does not ignore our failure. He is keenly aware of what we're going through. Then it says this: Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He's saying this is not a God who deals in permanent endings to things. This is a God whose purpose and power and presence extends way beyond what we can see in our limited vision. God is always moving beyond our failure. He is always seeing past what is wrong to the next good thing he wants to bring into our life. But he finishes with the best. He saves it for last. He says he gives strength to the weary. We all get weary, don't we? He increases the power of the weak. We all feel weak, don't we, from time to time? But when we hope in the Lord, it says, we will be renewed. We will soar. We're not just going to get by. We're going to soar. We're going to run. That is a promise. We don't get this on our own power. We get it from his power. After serving as the pastor of the gathering for 10 years, I had the opportunity to get to know many people who were defeated by their failure, and many people who moved beyond their failure. One person that comes to mind was Roger. I can share Roger's story with you because he shared it a million times. We first met Roger because he was sleeping in the stairwell next to the building where our church was located, and he had been for 18 months. But he discovered a church, and he discovered Jesus. One day, Roger came to the church to tell us that Jesus had visited him in a dream and had invited him to follow him, and Roger took the invitation. Soon after that, he began showing up to the front door of our church early in the morning to get coffee and a warm place to stay. And before long, we found out that Roger was gifted in organizational skills. After 2 years, our church had the opportunity to be a host for a ministry called Shalom that organized churches to feed the homeless. And Roger was interested in being a part of that. We wanted to participate, but we didn't have a coordinator. And then he stepped up. He served faithfully for 2 years. Eventually, the organization asked Roger to become one of two chief organizers of a citywide ministry, a network of partner churches that continue to bring hope to the homeless. During his time with Shalom, Roger met his wife, and on his wedding day, according to Roger, he became a husband, a father, a grandfather, all in one day. Today, Roger and his wife, Brittany, pack lunches for the homeless daily, and they still take food to anyone who needs it. Isaiah says, "Why do you complain? Why do you say my way is hidden from the Lord? Do you not know? Have you not heard? He gives strength to the weary. He brings us out of our failures." He says, "We will walk and not grow faint. We will run and not grow weary." So now you know, now you have heard. With Christ, there was no such thing as permanent failure. May this be your story and mine, now and always. Amen.